गुड डे फ्रेंड्स, आई एम सो हैप्पी टुडे। यस, एच ए पी पी वाई ऑल इन कैपिटल्स टुडे एंड आई विल टेल यू व्हाई, यू नो द रीजन व्हाई कोचिंग मैटर्स, यू नो, व्हिच इज अवर इंटरव्यू सीरीज विद द कोचेस इन डिफरेंट फील्ड्स इज एन अटेम्प्ट टू हाईलाइट द इम्पोर्टेंस ऑफ कोचिंग इन वेरियस फैसेट्स ऑफ लाइफ एज वेल एज प्रोफेशन। ऑल्दो द प्रोफेशन ऑफ कोचिंग ओरिजिनेटेड एंड स्टिल प्रोमिनेंटली एसोसिएटेड विद द फील्ड ऑफ स्पोर्ट्स एंड एथलेटिक्स, it has become very relevant in various dimensions of life, especially in the era that we are living in. Today I have a pleasure to interact with one of my former colleagues and a very good friend, Shailaja Kedari. Shailaja is a qualified chartered accountant turned happiness coach, and that was the reason I said happy all in caps, and that is also the reason for my happiness. She happily left behind a glamorous corporate life at a time when she was recognized as one of the valuable assets to an organization where we both work together. She is one of those coaches who keeps coaching herself, and she considers herself as her toughest student. And of course, she is all available to those who wish to be habitually happy through the simple and easy tools. The aim of coaching session is to be able to be happy today. Keep tuning into the one happy frequency, taking one day at a time, till the happy frequency becomes their default frequency and transforming their lives into happily ever after in every area of life. And I believe Shailaja also in profession. Shailaja, it's an absolute pleasure to interact with you today. Welcome to Coaching Matters.
Yeah, thank you, Priman. It's so nice to speak to you. Very happy.
Yeah, thank you for providing your consent. I'm sure, you know, people will be watching this with great interest, the following interaction. Let me begin by asking one question which actually came to me that, you know, being happy is supposed to be a natural state of human being. Then why do we need to learn to be happy, and why do we need a happiness coach like you?
Yeah, you're right. I mean, it's a natural state of being. That is absolutely true. Let's assume, Biman, you are the happiest person on earth, okay? Mm-hmm. And a child who was born has been given to you to be raised. Okay, how would you raise that child? Mm-hmm. What would be the thoughts that you would put into that child's mind, or the belief systems that the child would grow up with? Would he or she be a happy child? Yes,
yeah.
Or no?
Yeah, absolutely, yes.
Yeah, that's the obvious answer.
Yeah, so basically, you know, stay away from all negativities.
Exactly my point. So what is happening is, I mean, it's not the parents or the society in particular, a person that needs to be blamed for anything. It's the way we have all been brought up, that, you know, positivity and negativity, and it's the way we've been raised up as children. Okay, it really depends on what kind of exposure a child gets initially. Into how happy that child turns out to be as an adult. But it doesn't end there. Even if a person becomes grumpy or angry as a grown-up, the person can still, you know, go back to what he or she is supposed to be, naturally happy. So yes, we are all naturally happy, but we've been focused on the wrong things in life. Okay, let's say, you know, out there are all these hundreds of radio channels that you can tune into. Okay, one is playing all these sad songs, one is playing all these happy songs, one is playing all these exciting songs and peaceful songs. So it really depends on what you are tuning into every moment of your life. Mm-hmm. If you've been, you know, if you just happen to tune into a sad song, why stay there? Why stay on that radio channel? Why not tune into another frequency and get to a happy one? You know, and why not make it a habit to go back to that frequency again and again? Mm-hmm. So we get stuck. We get stuck in all these different kinds of areas that we focus on, you know, maybe all the bad news that we hear on TV and everything that we read in the newspaper. And then we get all the more sad, and then things start happening in our life too. We see traffic and we see some accident and stuff, all of that, you know. Wherever you can divert your focus, please do that. Mm-hmm. If you can't, then make it a habit of, you know, training yourself to divert your focus. It's like whatever mind focuses on, it absorbs. Mm-hmm. So you have to decide what you focus on. And that's why, that is the only reason why we've all been distracted in life. That's the only thing. We focus on all the different things which may not really contribute to our happiness. That's the reason why the natural state of being has changed to what it is. But we all know how to be happy, don't we?
Yeah,
we do, don't we? Mm-hmm. So it's just a matter of doing it again and again and again till it becomes a habit.
Yeah.
So that's why we need to, it's not learning, it's about refocusing. It's about refocusing. It's like when you hear that static, krr, krr, then you know, you need to fine tune. You need to fine tune again to the things that you want to. You know, if you want All Is Well song, you can't be tuning into Jaane Wo Kaise Log Thi Jinke Pyar Ko Pyar Mila and all that. So you get my point.
Yeah, absolutely.
So yeah, so you have to do that. You have to remind yourself again and again. And yeah, and no, we don't need a happiness coach. Nobody needs actually, because every human being is born with that potential to, you know, refocus. You know that when you're not feeling good, what do you want to do? The best. What do you want to do when you're not feeling good? You want to feel good, isn't it? So you don't need a coach to tell you that. And what makes you feel good? You also know as a human being, you do know that. So actually there's no need for a coach, but then, you know, people do need sometimes, and people like me who have made their own mistakes, had their own journey, teaching themselves. They find me, I find them, and then we exchange.
So Shailaja, you know, like my question was, you know, everybody knows how to be happy. Everybody also knows how to get into that state, to tune into that frequency at times. But it is, you know, very difficult to stay in that phase. There are thousands of quotes around happiness. There are again, you know, thousands of definitions around happiness. But now that you have researched a lot and studied this subject, you know, I would say, you know, as a subject matter expert, what's your definition of happiness?
Subject matter expert, there's this movie Matrix, you know that. And Morpheus tells Neo when they are fighting each other that, you know, don't think you are, know that you are. So there's a difference between thinking I am and knowing I am. So I'm in the process of thinking I am and transitioning into knowing I am. So I'm not the actual practical subject matter expert, but yeah, theory I've read a lot, so I can answer that on a theoretic basis. It is, yes, everyone knows how to tune in. It's just a matter of habit. You know, people have fallen out of the habit, people including myself, yourself, into the habit of seeing what is happening outside of us, be it family, relationships, friends, the weather. Some people, you know, I used to get sad when the weather changed. You know, if it was rainy season, I used to get sad. So what has the weather done, for example? How can you be sad when the weather is not good? You know, point being, when we focus on things outside of ourselves, whatever we see there affects our mood. Okay, on the other hand, when you are focusing on yourself, for example, even if you close your eyes and just sit still for a while, or look at a passing cloud. If you just look at a passing cloud, which is going slowly at its own pace, your mind settles down on, if at all you have to observe something outside of yourself, observe things that are good, like a passing cloud, or maybe a door which is closing really slowly instead of a door which is getting banged on. Okay, if at all you have to focus on things outside of yourself, focus on good things. And if at all you go a step further where you understand that that is not helping, you have to focus within. That is the best way of doing it. You know, there's this, you can catch this frequency anytime you want. It's like if you imagine yourself in a dark tunnel surrounded with all darkness, that's what sometimes we feel, you know, world outside of us, people are not behaving the way we want them to. Okay, of course they're not supposed to, isn't it? They don't have a heart and brain. It's all us. We are like, we want to control people, or we think like that, or the weather is not behaving that way, the traffic is not behaving. This is a dark tunnel that we are really focusing on, all the darkness which is outside. All right, if we just focus on that inner light, which is there, a little tiny little ray of light, even in the intense of the darkness, it's there. Okay, that ray of hope, you call it, or the light, you call it. If you just keep fine-tuning into that, you will really increase its illumination. It will really enlighten you, you know. Enlighten is what? Light you up. Yeah, it will enlighten you. And the moment you are able to fine-tune into it more habitually, and for stay there for a longer period of time, that's when you really kind of light up from the inside. And that's when this thing called, that is what is this thing called unconditional happiness is, according to me. Okay, it may seem like a big thing, okay, but it's like unconditional happiness is where you don't want conditions to remain happy. You are just happy because you know how to be. And of course, by happy, I mean all the other good vibes, like, you know, being peaceful. And even enlightenment, what's enlightenment? It's like that state of peace, which you are there, you know, you're there always, all the time. Then you're an enlightened being, all the time. We are all enlightened, you know, a few moments in a day, we all are, when we are really peaceful. And so making it a habit is what this coaching that I do is all about, you know, getting into that state more often than not. even I'm not there 100%, not at all. I mean, as I said, you know, I think I am, but I'm not yet. But this is what happiness is all about for me. It's like the unconditional happiness. I'm trying to do that myself. I keep coaching myself that I shouldn't be looking outside of myself for sources of happiness. Even if I do go there, I drag myself back in. I pull myself back in using these tools, very tools which I help other people use. So it's very simple tools, like, you know, 1 minute meditation, or if you can afford to have that 1 hour meditation and all these things. Whatever you can, just be focused within and develop that feeling of unconditional peace or happiness, which is not dependent on anyone or anything outside of you. Even if you go there, for example, even if you mess things up with people, with come back in. And eventually, it's not about time. It's about the focus. Mm-hmm. Eventually, you'll get to a place where you are, you just marinate and settle in yourself, where it doesn't matter what the outside world looks like, you know. And you're just there.
Yeah. You just marinate is the word.
And yeah. Marinate is the word. Yeah. Wow. You just marinated in that feeling. I get a glimpse of that more often than now, not nowadays. When I just messed up something on Monday, so big time. I'm pulling myself out of it. You know, I think I shouldn't be calling myself happiness coach. I should be calling myself hope coach, because that's what I keep giving myself, even when I mess things up badly. And I think I don't, you know, I'm very disappointed in myself. I'm like, I shouldn't be doing this. But then I'm like, okay, fine. I'm a hope coach. Then I say, hope is fine, right?
Yeah, even absolutely.
If I'm not happy, I'm hopeful. Hopeful all the time.
Yeah, these are all optimistic words. But you said, you know, you are still not there, and you are still in the process of, you know, knowing yourself. I have seen, you know, completely a different form of you, and I have also seen you transforming. I have seen you, working as a professional chartered accountant. And then you...
Yeah, workaholic I was.
Yeah.
And a tough master.
Before you, you know, pulled out yourself in, you know, from that world and announcing yourself as a happiness coach, what all changes you had to really face with your own personality, because you were a different person then?
Yeah, absolutely. I was, Biman, okay, fine. Why do you do whatever you're doing now? For example, what is your aim behind everything that you do?
Yeah, like,
you're conducting this.
Yeah, I call it a purpose of life or your inner calling.
Yeah. And how does that make you feel?
Absolutely happy, absolutely satisfied. There is a completely different sense of satisfaction.
Correct. So, in short, why do you do what you do? Because it makes you?
Makes me happy, makes me satisfied. Yeah, makes me feel contented.
Correct. Absolutely. So, that seems to be the ultimate aim of every person behind every action he or she takes. The feeling good
ideally,
part of it.
Yes.
You know? Feeling good yourself. Yes.
Yeah, ideally, yes.
So, so we are all doing that. We are all in pursuit of happiness, which was a very good movie, by the way.
Yeah.
Have you seen that?
Yes.
Yeah. So, yes. So we are all in pursuit of happiness. Just that we most of the times are looking in wrong places.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for example, I'm still very ambitious, very ambitious. I need a good home, a good car, and a good position in a good company, a lot of money and all these things. And I realized, you know, there is this law of diminishing marginal utility. I think most of us know that the first achievement, big achievement, good, very good, you are on the moon, and you know, you're like very satisfied and very happy and proud of yourself, but still you want more.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you get the other one, you're not that happy, you know, there's this thing that diminishes, the joy diminishes. And I faced the same thing. I was chasing happiness, I wanted all these things, thinking that, you know, this will give me satisfaction. So one thing after the other, be it money or career or even personal life. You know, people sometimes, they want to marry some person and they are like, yeah, iske baad main khush ho jaunga yaar. But, you know, how it works, you know, most of the people cry about marriage and stuff. So point being, when you're looking for happiness in all these places and all these things, do you get it? That is the question. Or the other way around, if you work, that if you just stay happy here unconditionally, and then you do whatever you're doing. That gives you more satisfaction, because the satisfaction is already here. You're 100% satisfied all the time. Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
That you're just 100% satisfied all the time. And then whatever you're doing is from that place of joy and peace and satisfaction. And that yields better results. Because I've noticed that in myself. I am intelligent, if I may say so myself.
mm-hmm.
But since I've started doing these things, being tuning more into the frequency of joy, I could find, even when I was working, that I could come up with solutions faster. I was mm-hmm. better with people.
Mm-hmm.
These things changed. Of course, I was really a taskmaster, and people used to be scared of me at work. And I've had some tiny little complaints also go to my superiors about the way I, bully people and all that. But then I eventually realized all these things where I'm searching for joy, I'm not getting it. So after a stage, I realized that's it. Now I have to go full time inside. There's mm-hmm. no point searching outside for anything. This law of diminishing marginal utility kicked in big time. No satisfaction. So I went in and I quit my job. And of course, I had one more good reason. My son, he was 3 years old. So I wanted to be with him. And I wanted to do this, self-actualize and improve myself.
Mm-hmm.
But this started while I was still on job. So I really saw people turn around in their opinion of me, in their attitude of me. The people who used to say things behind my back and not be comfortable talking to me, they now are, in the close circle of friends. They are the best of my friends now. I'm a bit surprised at how these things can work. When you work on your inner self, things turn around. I'm not, again, 100% not there yet. There are still some people who I rub the wrong way and still not happy with me, especially the closest of us, the mm-hmm. closest family members. They are the ones who suffer the most.
Mm-hmm.
They are the one who get to see the changed you the last.
Mm-hmm.
If you know what I mean,
Yeah,
people true. Outside of you, your colleagues, your friends, they all get the best of you, but at home it comes last. So, which is all right. I think I'll get there. Mm-hmm. I cannot give up, I've come too far. Cannot go back. So, yeah. So, yes, I've changed a lot. And these changes I had to bring in myself. One of the biggest steps that I took was this Vipassana meditation, if you have heard about it. That really started off, when I started realizing that something was missing. This is something which came into my menu, and this is the beauty of it. When you know what you want, things start showing up.
Yeah.
When you know that you want to go inside, mm-hmm. things start showing up. So this Vipassana, I just fell into my the word, and then I kind of Googled it and found out, and then I realized in theory where I was going wrong, and then it has been some time. I reinvent wheel. There are some people who reinvent wheel. They just don't learn from others' mistakes, right? So I'm that kind of a person. I don't know why I don't learn from others' mistakes. It would have been an easy journey for me. But I've been reinventing my wheel every single step of the way. And I think I've done fairly well for myself, except for some punctures here and there.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how I started my transformation. And then I read a lot, these books and all these, self-help books.
Mm-hmm.
And so these changes happened. And then suddenly, there were people who wanted some advice from me, which also I did not go ahead and ask.
Mm-hmm.
Or tell them. It's just that, the vibes, the frequency, it just magically happens.
Mm-hmm.
There were people coming to me, somehow they used to open up, just all of a sudden they used to open up about some problem. I used to tell them something, and then they used to find it really useful. And so this kept happening and happening and happening. And then suddenly I realized, well, yeah, that's good. I can do this. There are people, it helps them as well as me, because it helps me fine tune again. It helps them fine tune.
Mm-hmm.
So then I started doing that. And then then the happiness coach thing happened.
Mm-hmm.
And I did a couple of trainings, in big trainings, say 5-day trainings in a friend's office, and then they had some good results, and so it mm-hmm. encouraged me. But I just don't go out there and search, because I think I'm still too imperfect. I don't want to go full-fledged. So I'm happy wherever things happen, the way it happens. Yeah. Word of mouth.
Yeah. So, Shailaja, in a world, where negativity really spreads very fast, and we all know that. So, in this world where it, spreads really, really fast, how do you help people to shield themselves to stay positive in a positive frame of mind all the time?
Well, it's first and foremost, negativity doesn't spread fast. We think so because we think so, especially when we look at the half empty cup. Mm-hmm. If you keep looking at the full part of it, the glass is half full, then you really don't see negativity a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. It's like when you start working on yourself, a very tiny example would be whenever I open a newspaper, suddenly somehow my sight falls on a piece of good news, which will be hidden somewhere, mm-hmm. which is not even the main event or something. I'm not able to quickly see the bad ones, So once you keep working on yourself, this happens. You automatically start seeing the cup half full.
Mm-hmm.
So when you keep start, like, for example, even if you talk about scientifically speaking also, these low emotions like sadness or negativity, they vibrate at a very heavy pace, you know. Mm-hmm. We don't have the time to go into all these technical details.
Yeah.
Energy, vibration and frequency. For example, the fan, when it's rotating at a speed of 1 versus when it's going at a speed of 5.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the one speed, let's say, is the negative emotions, the sad emotions, which make you feel heavy, which make you feel all clumsy and slow. And the highest frequency ones are like 5 or 6. You know, mm-hmm. you feel really light. You see that? You feel really light and fast and frisky. So then what travels fast? The lighter ones travel fast, don't they? The heavier yeah. ones don't.
Mm-hmm.
Also, technically, logically, scientifically speaking.
Yeah.
So just because we are focused on a lot of negative things, we see it spreading fast. It doesn't, first and foremost. If we start thinking on these lines, automatically we keep focusing on the positivity that mm-hmm. shows up in our day.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, if you look at your day, for example, let's say Monday was a big example. Mm-hmm. The day was really bad because I messed up, as I said. Mm-hmm. But that day, it seemed like it was a disaster.
Mm-hmm.
But today, when I look back on that day, the day went well, really well. Even if the things which I messed up, that made me all the more refocused on yeah. the things that I should be doing.
But
know?
That's the realization, well. Right, Shailaja? That's the realization that, okay, that day was actually really well. It really went well. And this is precisely yeah, what yeah. happens with people, you know, when they are in that moment of sadness or yeah, any, yeah. you know, any negative things yes. that are happening around them or happening with them.
Correct.
How can they quickly come back to that, you know, positive state of mind?
Yeah, well, as I said, these simple tools which I say, you know, I've and the trainings which I had taken, I used to take, actually, it was more of, say, 90% practice and, you know, 10% of theory, which I used to do in these trainings. And I used to really, every half an hour, every 10 minutes, I used to tell them to write something or just go into 1 minute meditation,
mm-hmm.
you know. So all these tiny little tools, and for example, you can make a list of things which feel good for you.
Mm-hmm.
And whenever there is a trigger, what is a trigger? A sadness or a heaviness or that static crrr, which says you're not tuned in properly.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you keep a list of these things to do. And then you do at least one of them, which takes maybe 30 seconds or 20 seconds. We have to work on these things. Once we get into the habit of fine tuning, then these ideas occur automatically. You don't have to force yourself to remember, you know, mm-hmm. that you're sad now. You have to do something. You will do something.
Mm-hmm. So any example of, you know, yeah. people finding their own ways, methods, tools, you know, apart from the tools that you are handing them off?
Yeah, well, I don't hand them, you know, I play very lazy here. I tell them to keep a list, to okay. make a list in my workshop, because it's individual, you know, every person has it, isn't it? Mm-hmm. So I tell them to make a list. And majority of the people come up with really nice things, like, you know, songs. Songs are like one of the top 5 things that people do. Mm-hmm. The songs. And if you're really sad and grumpy, my question is, do you remember to think of a song? You don't. So you have to keep it somewhere in front of you to really trigger your memory.
Okay.
To trigger. Even I'm saying all these things, even when I'm really sad and grumpy, sometimes I just go with the flow
mm-hmm.
and just vent it out. I don't know who that victim is, bichara victim, and then I profusely apologize, be it a family member or friend or someone close. But then you learn, isn't it? Eventually yeah. you learn, and then you know that this is a disaster. I don't want that disaster again and again, neither for me or for anyone else. I don't want to hurt other people. I'm doing that. When I'm sad, I'm hurting other people also.
Mm-hmm.
And that also again gives me that guilt rise. So I know I don't want to get into that cycle. So I try my best to remind myself again and again. And I do get, I'm from my own progress, as I said, I reinvent the wheel. So I'm the toughest student I've ever faced.
Mm-hmm.
So from all this, I understand that it's possible. If I can do it, God, anyone can do it.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Because my pendulum swings to the extremes. Either I'm like ecstasized, if I don't know if that's a word, ecstasy, a complete in ecstasy or bliss, and then the other time I'm like, you know, this side, completely depressed, and I sometimes wonder, am I clinically insane or something? And then I realize, no, I'm not. I'm just a bit too high on emotions. You know, I process emotions really intensely. So I might come to a stage where I'm really stable. That is where I will know that I am. Till then, I'm thinking that I am.
Mm-hmm.
So you can do it, and if I can do it, by God, anyone can do it. And it's like about constant reminders, keeping all these reminders in front of you till the reminder comes automatically from within.
Becomes a habit.
So these lists go, automatically it will come from within. It's like this, when you tune into that frequency, your favorite songs start playing, mm-hmm. one after the other. You really don't have to remind yourself. The reminders automatically start coming in.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't have to really, again, there's this one thing, how long I have to, try to be happy.
Mm-hmm.
So the point is, it's only as long as it becomes a habit.
Mm-hmm.
And how quick can you form that habit?
So Shailaja, through this happiness coaching that you are doing, what kind of transformation mm-hmm. one can expect at the end of your happiness coaching sessions?
In theory, I've seen people, they realize for the first time, maybe a lot of people, that whatever is happening to them, it is directly connected to their mood. The way the things are happening around them, the way they perceive them, is directly connected to their mood. So it's as simple as that if you are in a very happy mood, let's say you are in a very peaceful mood or any of the good feeling vibes, whatever is happening around you, if it's good, positive, it really amps you up. If it's negative, it kind of bounces away. Okay? It's as if it's not there. You don't notice these things. So this really keeps you in a very, a good, peaceful bubble.
Okay.
Or it keeps you in a natural state all the mm-hmm. time, irrespective of what is happening around you. All right? So this is what people, at least in theory, they realize. And going one step ahead, I don't know if we have a lot of time to discuss this, but this mood of yours, this frequency of yours, in addition to keeping you happy in your present circumstances, also creates favorable circumstances for you.
Mm-hmm.
It creates favorable circumstances. In those 5 days of half-day trainings, I used to take half-day trainings, and we called it one day at a time. Being happy today. So one day at a time, we named that training. And within those 5 days, I've seen people come up and tell me that, I was thinking this, I was in this kind of a good mood, and suddenly this kind of good thing happened.
Mm-hmm.
Which was very surprising. Now, there's this one guy, which is a very fascinating example. This one guy who used to drink, I think he said 3 or 4 pegs every day.
Mm-hmm.
That was a big complaint with the people at his home.
Mm-hmm.
And during these sessions, these 5 days, in the middle somewhere, second or third day, he comes and tells me, yesterday, madam, what I did, I just took one little peg and I poured water in it, a full glass full, and I kept sipping at it. So that day, I think in the first time in several years, he just took that much, just one peg or something. I'm not saying, that it is good or bad. It's not about what is good or what is bad. It's just saying that these things, when you focus inner,
mm-hmm.
happy, changing yourself unknowingly. He did not have to stop himself from, going ahead and taking another 2 pegs. It automatically happened. So good, bad, I'm not discussing that right now. I'm just saying there are changes, noticeable changes. And then there's this girl, she says her marriage was suffering and they were almost at the verge of divorce and it did not happen. She says, she found hope in these 5 days. And mm-hmm. she realized that whatever is happening with me, I'm not the victim of circumstances. I can change it. It makes people empowered. They themselves realize, as I said, it's 90% practice. So I really don't, register a lot of theory into them, or I don't really inject a lot of coaching or pushing into them.
Mm-hmm.
What I tell them to do is come up with your own ideas, come up with your own thoughts. It's more mm-hmm. like, they write something, they discuss something, then we do some activity to lighten up the mood. Then we again go back into a minute meditation or 2 minutes meditation, or I ask them to suggest.
Mm-hmm.
Them to suggest in the days, in those 4 hours, I ask them to suggest happy little fine tuning, which they
okay.
can come up with. So in those 5 days, if you really are focused enough, you really form a very good part of this habit.
Mm-hmm.
So that has happened. There are a lot of such things which people come up and say that, the flip side to this is you cannot blame others for the way you feel.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, it's very easy, women, this girl, she stressed me out. Oh, you cannot blame yourself for that. This is really, and it really makes you mad when you think that you cannot blame anything outside of yourself for the things that is happening to you. So
mm-hmm.
at least this kind of a responsibility,
mm-hmm.
the people know that, they are in control of their experience, of their mood. Yes. If they don't forget about experience, I just say you control your mood and everything falls into place.
Mm-hmm.
So in theory, yes, people understand this. In practice, well, it's a matter of how focused you are. And as I said, the more focused you are and the more desperate you are, it's just a matter of focus and you get there
mm-hmm.
immediately. There have been people who've got there. There are some people, who are still struggling. But it's okay. At least we know, we were just going along the day, taking in whatever is happening and knowing that, oh no, I'm not responsible, things are happening to me. But at least after these workshops, it's not like that. They at least know that things are not happening to me. Mm-hmm. I'm making these things happen.
Okay.
Now, how easily you're able to stop them and change them, it really depends on how focused you are.
So that's the shift that is happening in their thinking level, isn't it?
Yes. In understanding thinking, yes. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So Shailaja, that you know you've been interacting with a lot of people on this particular aspect of happiness, what are the typical problems people have with their state of mind, or what kind of things that they usually mess up with?
Oh well, it's first and foremost they say abhi itne dinon ki aadat hai, we've been doing this for all these years, being easily led by the circumstances, or being sad, being happy, depending upon who says what or who does what. So how is this going to change? And this is just an example. There are tons of belief systems that we have. We have pre-childhood or that we've So the question is, how is this going to go away? Mm-hmm. So the answer in theory is very simple. Let's say a room was in darkness for thousands of years. Mm-hmm. Okay. Do you really have to sweeping the darkness away bit by bit, or you simply light a lamp and it, mm-hmm. the darkness disappears? Yeah. However long it has been there, it doesn't matter. This I keep reminding myself also, Biman, because I know there are some beliefs and it just comes up. You don't even know that you're living with this belief and it just comes up. You don't even know that you're living with these insecurities and something new happens in your life, some fears, and they come up. Mm-hmm. And then suddenly I have to tell myself, "Arey, itne saalon ka I have been suffering these insecurities since childhood. How can I let them go?" Then I have to tell myself, no, you don't have to really suffer darkness anymore. You just have to click a switch, and the light comes on.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to train yourself into believing that all these belief systems are also just a click away from disappearing.
Mm-hmm.
That all these negativities, everything that we carry, what is it? I mean, all the limitations and everything comes from every negativity. Let's just put all our feelings and emotions and thoughts into two buckets, positive and negative. That's all it is, isn't it?
Right.
So whatever is negative is not serving you. Whatever is positive is serving you. You have to keep reminding yourself to fine-tune into the positive.
Mm-hmm.
And that as soon as you fine-tune into the positive, the negative is gone, okay? Unless you start looking into the negative again.
Right.
So it's, you have to train yourself. Yeah, you have to train yourself in practice also. As I said, there's a difference between you, what you think you are and what you know you are. So we are all doing that. We are all training ourselves in our own ways to keep tuning into the positive, to keep looking at the light, to keep telling ourselves that we've switched on the light. Now the darkness is gone.
Mm-hmm.
Don't keep thinking about the darkness. We keep thinking about the darkness even sitting in the light.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what's happening with us. The darkness is gone. As soon as you understand, at least in theory, that you can do it. You can light up a lamp. You can flip the switch and be enlightened. So it's just a matter of reminding ourselves time and time again.
Right.
Again, getting into the habit.
Yeah. So Shailaja, I know you. Shailaja, you mentioned about, people carry a lot of belief system because, through their upbringing, they have picked up a lot of wrong beliefs maybe, or, wrong methods of, carving their way out. So when you coach someone, whether, somebody who is coaching or, someone like me, for example, who is an executive coach, or somebody who is into fitness coaching, usually, they have to really make their counterparts to go through some pains as they transit from one state to another state. So wherever, whatever the state is to the next higher level state. Is it true for happiness coaching as well? Because they have to unlearn a lot of things. They have to give up a lot of bad habits, wrong beliefs.
Yeah.
Or do they give up something and develop new habits or a new regime?
Well, again, it depends on the individual. Let's say this, the darkness and light thing, which I said, there are people who are able to really adopt, that. So it's easy for them. Now, what is the definition of easy and hard? What is easy and what is hard? Easy is that which feels good. Simply speaking,
absolutely,
easy is that which feels good.
Yeah.
Okay. Hard is that which feels hard. It doesn't feel good, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So if I say let's say to transform yourself, you have to do these minute meditations. Let's say 1 minute every half an hour, 1 minute every half an hour. This 1 minute, does it feel good? It surely does to most people.
Mm-hmm.
So that is easy. So if you just look at all the good things you're doing, the transformation should be easy.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Now, if you're thinking, of course, the hard part is somewhere where you realize you get into the habit of being happy all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then suddenly when you dip somewhere, then you think it was sadness was a routine once upon a time. Now when you're sad, you really feel it. You really feel, you know, you feel it intensely. So once upon a time, it was okay for me to be angry. All day long, I used to be angry. And all day long, I used to sulk and be sad and, you know, vent out at others and make them miserable, share my grief with them and make them grievous. So it was okay for me. But now when I do this once in a while, so once in a while when I hurt someone or once in a while when I act irrational, that really kills me, you know. That's really intense for me because now I'm in a habit of being more and more lighthearted. So when I get really grumpy or serious, oh my goodness, I cannot tolerate it. So in a way, it's like people who've given up smoking. There's a friend of mine who's given up smoking. He says once upon a time, it was okay to keep on smoking and things. But now when somebody else smokes, he's not able to tolerate even that smell.
He gets irritated.
You know, so it is. Yeah, so that is hard. You know, that is, he gets irritated, not because he's tempted. But because he's irritated, he cannot tolerate that smell. Now there will be a stage where it doesn't matter. The other next stage will be where it doesn't matter. You know, he'll be like, all fine. You want to smoke, smoke. It doesn't matter. So that is the stage we are all aiming at.
Yeah.
Where it doesn't really matter. So
and then that's the real transformation.
This thing. So this part where you know that you can be limitlessly happy or blissful all the time. And when you see that you're not doing that, when you see that you're still wanting others to make you happy, you know, it was easy to be unaware, and ignorance is bliss, bolte na. So you were ignorant, you know, you were like, this person is not making me happy. You blame this person and that person and this thing, but now you cannot blame them. Now you are at least theoretically aware that you have to do it. So this is a little hard. This is the only hard thing which I know, you know, how to ignore circumstances and again, stay focused and be gentle on yourself. I'm not most of the time, but be gentle on yourself when you're going through this transformation. Don't kind of beat yourself up because you felt bad. It happens that I felt bad. So you beat yourself up and you feel all the more bad. So these things happen. So this is the only hard part where you're transitioning. Otherwise, it has to be blissful. Journey has to be blissful.
I like that word, you know, bliss or being blissful, you know, this probably is connected to spirituality. And talking about spirituality, you know, I often listen to Jaggi Vasudev, one of the spiritual gurus, you know, and he says it's possible to be.
I like him.
And he says, you know, it's possible to stay in meditative state as long as you want. I find this explanation, you know, about being in meditative state for a very long period, very, very convincing. But how about happiness? Can one really be happy in happy state at all the times?
What is the feeling or what is the state when you say meditative state? How does it feel inside? How does it feel inside?
Yeah, I think, you know, initially just it starts with, you know, just being with yourself. Yeah, just being with yourself or, you know, trying to, you know, sort of do an introspection, probably taking an account of what's going wrong or what's going right. And then in the process, probably you start discovering, you know, in the process of, you know, discovering right or wrong, you start discovering, you know, the inner peace. And then slowly that, you know, joyful state starts coming up.
Inner peace.
Yeah.
Yes. So that's the state of peace. Let's say meditative is a state of peace. Okay.
Yeah.
So being in a state of peace, which again is the same, what's in the name, you know, a rose by any other name would smell as sweet. Peace, happiness, positivity, bliss, ecstasy, all different states which we want, which we desire, all of us desire.
Yeah.
So it's like when you get into the habit of being at that peace, state of peace or joy or whatever it is, you can carry it with you, like your essence. Like, for example, it's like, you know, everyone has experienced this. For example, something good happened or you're in a really good mood and you just walk around as if you're, you know, you're over the moon. You know, you just walk around. You don't notice anything. You're oblivious to your surroundings and the easiest feeling to describe is the feeling of being in love, you know, where you're like all happy and smiling at yourself. And have you been in love, Piman? Understand maybe.
Yeah, of course. Mine was a love marriage.
I'm not just talking about romance. Absolutely. So you know the initial days, you know, you're over the moon all the time.
Yeah.
So it really doesn't matter who says what or, you know, your whatever is going wrong, right? You're there. You're in that state of eternal bliss. Okay. So just imagine that and imagine that that happened because you were in love. Again, something in which you might say that was out of your control.
Yeah.
But imagine if you could do this consciously. You come to a state of mind of your choosing. Call it whatever you want. Call it bliss and peace, or you know, being in love is a state where most of the people recognize mm-hmm. that this is how. Yeah. So when we are talking about, we all understand peace. How does peace feel?
Yeah.
They're words, all right. But you know, we have associated different feelings to them. How does bliss feel? How does happiness feel? And we are capable. Okay, we are capable of consciously choosing a particular frequency. Let's say frequency, like we choose the radio frequency. Let's say I want to choose the frequency of bliss. I say, okay, fine. I'm going to choose this frequency and stay in that state. We can do it. Okay, every human being has this potential. Every single human being has this potential. And you know, also in theory, that we do have. Right? Do you agree?
Yeah.
If I ask any person, yeah, you have the potential. Now the question is, are we utilizing that potential?
Mm-hmm.
And how do we do that? So how do we do that? Are all these different tools and techniques that we use, like we meditate or we try to, but this, there's again this belief system which says, you know, that we cannot always be in a happy state. There are things happening around us mm-hmm. which draws our attention, which may not be good. But again, going back to our discussion that we had so long, that if you go within and if you're able to fine tune every single time, irrespective of your circumstances, you can stay, right? You can stay in that state of bliss all the time.
Right.
All the time, 24/7. And it becomes a habit. It becomes, you've of course met people who are happier often than not, isn't it? And you've met people who are more grumpy than they are happy, isn't it?
Right.
So you can choose it. We are actually unconsciously walking through life, most of us. And we can choose to consciously choose these states and stay in them, determine that we have to, because there's no other way of living happily ever after. You know, you have to choose and stay. You have to choose and stay. And choose again and again and again and again and again.
Mm-hmm.
So there'll come a time where you, by default, you know, you are happy. Of course, you are sad or rest of the negative some of the times, but you're able to pull yourself back in. And then there will be a time where you're, what are these enlightened masters, like just say Gautam Buddha or even Jaggi Vasudeva or anyone who's really, you know, in that state of bliss all the time, are they not? So
yeah.
they are capable of doing that. Even if they slip off, I don't think they do. I mean, I would like to believe that they're always in that state, but even if they do, they know how to come back quickly without causing further damage to anybody else around them.
Mm-hmm.
So we can all do that, and we don't have to reinvent wheel all the time. We have all these learned masters, and because of internet and all these videos, it's amazingly easy now to really understand the specifics of how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So everyone can do it.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone is a self-taught happiness coach, really,
mm-hmm.
because we keep coaching ourselves every day in and out.
Yeah, I think it's all about, you know, being more self-aware about yourself, recognizing the emotions that that's, you know, going through, that's coming
yes.
in, going out.
Yes.
One of the things that...
Or simply speaking, you just pay attention to, are you happy in this moment or are you not? If you're not happy, would you like to get happy?
Hmm.
That is the question. If the answer is yes, you better do something about it.
Yeah. It's
otherwise, you stay grumpy.
Yeah, it's going to be a natural answer for anybody, you know, and that's where I think this coaching
exactly.
comes in picture. I think, you know,
yeah.
already 3-4 times you said that nobody needs happiness coach. And I also would like to believe that nobody needs a fitness coach or an executive coach or relationship
okay.
coach, because it's all in there.
Yeah.
But still people...
It's there, right.
Because, you know, that's all because of the, you know, human tendency, which has a tendency to go back to their, you know, state. You know, we call it comfort zone. People like to, you know, live their life with their old methods, their own way of, you know.
Yeah. Even if it's highly uncomfortable, okay? Even if it's highly uncomfortable, we call it comfort zone, but it's not comfortable being there.
And that's where I think
it's,
you know,
a matter of
thinking, matters come in picture, and you need to really push people to believe that, no, that's not really comfortable stage, you know, even though they believe that it's very comfortable for them. So how much of that pushing you need to do when it comes to happiness coaching, Shailaja? And that happens to be my last question.
Yeah, okay. Pushing is not happy, by the way, Biman. It's not a very happy vibe, you know, pushing. Because that itself has a lot of resistance.
Even if it is for somebody else's happiness?
Yeah, well, that's a dicey question. but I invite. I push myself. But where it comes to others, I push myself and my husband and my son. But where it comes to others, I invite them. if you know what the difference is. You know, it's like gyan dena ho na. If I have to say you have to do this and that, I keep pushing my son on these aspects, and sometimes my hubby if he listens to me. But this, besides that, Biman, your video is gone. Yeah, you're back again. Besides that, I invite people to, now in these 5 days coaching that I conduct, people are really blissed out, you know. First day, it's all right. People are just like, "Arey, kya ho raha hai? What's she doing? And what are these minute meditations?" I've seen that second, third day onwards, when we finish that last, I always finish with that 1 or 2 minute meditation. And people just sit there and I ask them to stretch and, you know, yawn and really feel free. And nobody gets up from their seat. They just sit there. And I say, go. They're like, you know, they are in that dazed state and they're like, huh, jate hain. They just sit there. And this I've seen in 3 batches I've conducted. All 3 batches, second, third day onwards, they just don't want to get up and leave. They're all relaxed and, you know, not that because I speak a lot or they want to listen to me. They just relax and they sit there. Okay. So this is the invitation I give to them, that you can feel like this every single day, provided you do these things. They are like, what happens when you go away? Mm-hmm. I said, that's not the aim. I'm not doing these things so that you constantly need someone to coach you. No, I'm because it's practical, you know, it's not theory.
Mm-hmm.
So I tell them, you have to do this. These are all the practical tools. You add up, keep adding up. And you have to feel like this every moment, that, you know, wherever you are innerly, inwards, you are settled. You know, you understand the feeling of settle ho gaya main, you know, I'm settled. So it has to be a feeling inside and not depending on the circumstances of where you are. You need to keep yourself marinated in that feeling.
Mm.
And that you can do yourself. So this is an invitation, more of an invitation that I give to people, that, you know, this is a feeling that you can have all the time. And you don't need me or anybody else. You just, what have I done? I've also done the same things. I've watched videos because I don't like to be sad. I don't like to be miserable.
Mm.
And happy feels good, you know. So I try to pull myself up into these feelings all the time. Yeah. So you also can do it. Just refuse to be sad. Even if you're sad in that moment, you flow away, fine, never mind. But your aim should always be to come back to your default factory setting.
Mm-hmm.
So there are a lot of examples. I give, one being your skull. Can you imagine your skull, only the skull, you know, not with the face and the nose and features. The grumpiest of the man, if you look at his skull, how does the skull look? How does the skull look? Yeah, it's the same, and it's got all these teeth, you know, it's just laughing away, isn't it? A skull is laughing. It shouldn't be a sign of danger. It should be a sign of happiness, shouldn't it? Just imagine a skull, its eyes are wide open, wonder. And it's laughing away. All 32 teeth can be seen if the person had 32.
Yeah.
Yes. So this example itself, when I was giving it, it really changed my way of looking at a skull.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's no more a sign of danger for me. It's a sign of joy, for example.
Mm-hmm.
So that is your default factory setting. Every grumpy person's skull is actually smiling away or laughing away.
Mm-hmm.
So these things, in theory, they understand. Some things are really, they cause some shift within the program, within the 5 days or whatever the duration is, but otherwise, yeah, it's feeling good is a good invitation. So they have to decide what they want to do. And of course, there are people who come back asking things, and I again give them the same advice. It's like more like I don't work on their individual belief systems. I just tell them to switch the light on so that all these belief systems fall away. I don't work individually with, you know, their personal problems or this or that. I just tell them this is the way you're supposed to be. If you're happy inside, all these dark areas fall away. So you just have to keep holding on to that light inside you. So that's what I invite them to do. Looking within and staying illuminated.
Right. And how much of your presence really matters?
I try to do the same.
Yeah. How much of your presence, you know, or you being the conductor of the course or as a happiness coach really matter then? Because, you know, once people start learning, let's say a few tricks and some tools that you introduce them to.
Uh-huh.
Obviously, probably they are supposed to spread the same thing around, at least, you know, their near ones and dear ones. Are they able to do they have to send?
Yeah, they do.
That's really the transformation, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. Because since the first day I started coaching or the first training I took, and this is what I do, you know, I ask people to go implement and give me their feedback right away in those 5 days time. I cannot just wait for you know, maybe next month or next year or anything. So I tell them, you do it today. Whatever you're, you know, understanding today, you go home and do it today. So there was one lady who said that, there was this example I gave, that when you're sad or negative, you feel all tight and closed inside.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. When you're happy, you feel loose.
Mm-hmm.
So just be a loser, I said. Be a loser for life. Always stay lose. So she went and explained this to her family, her kid, and her kid to date. I mean, it's been, I think, 3 or 4 years, maybe. I don't know. Last time I met her, she said her kid understands that now.
Okay.
Tight and loose.
Mm-hmm.
It's about happy, not happy. He understands tight and loose. Isn't that amazing? You know. So yes, people do share that. There are plenty of examples. I don't want to really drag on this interview. I know we are short on time.
Right.
So absolutely, they share because this is such a simple thing to understand, you know, and they want everyone else to know this also.
Right.
And so they share and they come and tell me. I encourage these kind of participation so that it really marinates into their heart and mind that this is something which is easily doable provided you are willing to do it.
Fantastic. Excellent, excellent talk, Shailaja. I think, you know, I've been listening to these talks, you know, quite some time on different forums. You know, we have been interacting with each other. But I think today you introduce several new terminologies and also, you know, various other aspects of happiness. So I can only end this session by saying that, you know, happiness is a choice, as they say in one of the quotes. And if you make that choice, I think you really don't need anything. Everything that you want in life is probably the final destination is happiness. Thank you so much.
Absolutely. It's the journey and the destination. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you, Biman. Thank you for the interview. It was a pleasure. Absolutely.
Yeah. Same here. Thank you so much. Thanks for your time.
Thank you.